While Digital Homicide stayed mostly quiet, Jim Sterling decided to cover other trash games on Steam, including two particular games. One was called Devil's Share, a first-person horror shooter where you fight demons, which has your usual bad indie game tropes. And the other was Galactic Hitman, an FPS that takes place on a space station that also has your usual bad indie game tropes, but is especially bad because of the game being easy to exploit, as you can literally just crouch the whole time, and the enemies will never hit you. The games were developed by a company known as ECC Games, but it was later revealed that this was yet another sock puppet that Digital Homicide tried to use. Even more so, a website known as BundleBlitz.com also cropped up, offering Steam keys for those games, and other games made by DigiHom's sock puppets for free in exchange for votes on Steam Greenlight for certain indie games, including more Digital Homicide games. Wouldn't you know it, this too was made by Digital Homicide, which should have been obvious from the Slaughtering Grounds font all over the website. Also, for some reason, the website used pictures of scantily clad women holding footballs. Why they did this, I don't know, but let's move on. Things got even more insane when Jim got an email from ECC Games. The real ECC Games. See, while Digital Homicide had made a sock puppet under that name, there was in fact a real ECC Games from Poland who was a mobile developer and who had nothing to do with either Steam or Digital Homicide. They actually told Jim that they were taking legal action against the Romines for stealing their name and using it as one of their sock puppets. In order to try and evade this, Digital Homicide changed their ECC Games to Every Click Counts and ignored any evidence and accusations pointed towards them. After enough pressure, they decided to go for broke and started pushing more and more games onto Steam Greenlight using the same tactic American Dad had Roger use in that episode where they parodied James Bond. If there's so much crap of some kind of entertainment being pumped out, people will have nowhere else to go for whatever form of entertainment that you're using that they want. BundleBlitz was soon transformed into an official Digital Homicide page, and at one point, revealed that they had 9 different games they were trying to push through Greenlight on top of all the other indie games they had listed, which, in fact, were DigiHom games, despite every game listed not using Digital Homicide as its developer or its publisher, instead hiding behind more sock puppets. It's worth noting that Digital Homicide claims that they work hard on the games they make, which couldn't possibly be further from the truth if they kept trying to churn out game after game on Steam Greenlight. While Digital Homicide was becoming more exposed for the total frauds that they were, Jim got a phone call from Robert Romine, who stated that he just wanted to talk with Jim, while also threatening him over and over about how he had a lawyer who wanted to sue him for defamation. His reason for this threat was that, in an article published on Jim's official website, thejimquisition.com, Jim made an article about Digital Homicide's work, saying that one of the pieces of artwork that Galactic Hitman used was stolen from DeviantArt, just like the artwork from the Slaughtering Grounds. However, very soon after that article was posted, Jim edited the article, saying that it's possible the artwork was bought, as it was also available on Shutterstock. However, Robert insisted that this still counts as defamation in his home state of Arizona, and thus, he would sue Jim for that, unless Jim signed an agreement penned by Robert's lawyer, in which Jim promised to never talk about Digital Homicide ever again, for threat of being sued. While Jim was calm and eventually said he would hold off on talking about Digital Homicide, which seemed to appease Robert, Jim also mentioned that he would have to talk with his legal advisor, which is something you kind of have to do if somebody else is threatening to sue you, and that made Robert angry, causing him to say that a decision had been made before he abruptly hung up. Jim's legal advisor told him that Jim would be fine, however, and everything seemed to be okay. For about 5 months. Now is where the story gets to the real interesting part. On March 16th, 2016, Jim got a knock on his door from a sheriff of the Jackson, Mississippi Police Department, telling Jim that he was being sued by James Romine. Not Digital Homicide, not both James and Robert, just James. This is an important factor to note as it's the legal name on the lawsuit. This is also quite possibly the largest part of the video and the reason I was forced to split it into two parts. All the legal stuff Digital Homicide did throughout 2016. First things first, the lawsuit against Jim. James had filed a lawsuit against Jim under the counts of libel, slander, and assault. and the value they were suing for, $10,761,000. James was so delusional that he thought he would get over $10.5 million from Jim Sterling. How did he reach this number? He considered $2,261,000 from direct product damage, $4.3 million from emotional, reputational, and financial distress, and $5 million for punitive damage requests. What's that? Those numbers don't add up to what James Ramin was asking for? Congrats! You passed the first Guess What's BS About This Lawsuit test! Here's some of the specific details about what James was demanding from Jim.
Full reimbursement for 5 years of lost product value at the per game value at time of loss, $19,000 per product at 12 products for 5 years, $1 million, $140,000.
Basically saying that Jim is responsible for the games not making as much money as something like a Capcom game, or even something like Shovel Knight. Never mind that he was selling each game at roughly $10 a game, sometimes on sale. $500,000 due to emotional distress from lost wages, which resulted in a lower quality of life for James, and not being able to visit his family, even though he was pumping out his garbage games faster than Scott Cawthon churns out Five Nights at Freddy's media. $832,500 that James apparently lost because he had to research law, and thus couldn't pump out more of his games. Oh, you heard that right. James is saying that because he couldn't afford a lawyer, we'll get to that part soon enough, Jim owes him over 800 grand. Oh, I'm sorry. This is just, some of the things James asked for are just absolutely stupid, and this is one of them. $1.25 million for difficulty in getting work in the gaming industry, including finding work within the AAA gaming industry, which is something James has always wanted to do. So because James and Robert made crap games, people called them crap, and then the brothers threw a hissy fit because people called them crap, they think that it's Jim's fault they can't get a job in the gaming industry ever again. That's the equivalent of abusing an animal, getting convicted of animal abuse, and then suing the police and court systems because you couldn't get your dream job of working for Petco or PetSmart. That $5 million in punitive damages? Basically a punishment to stop Jim and other gaming critics for saying mean and nasty things about digital homicide. This basically was the point of the whole lawsuit. He wanted to get Jim to shut up about digital homicide and get other people who criticized him to stop so that way he could keep peddling his garbage. Pretty sure that's not legal. And then there's the last bit. Apologies in place of every article and video Jim's made about digital homicide for at least 5 years. As well as an apology video that has to stay on the front page of Jim's YouTube page for that amount of time. Also, Jim has to stop talking about James Ramin, digital homicide, and anyone who works for DigiHom for the next 10 years. Okay, that is definitely illegal. That's a direct violation of the First Amendment as it violates freedom of speech. You can't legally force someone to stop talking about you and the people you work for. Oh my god, this is the stupidest lawsuit I've ever seen. Just give me a minute. I need to catch my breath. Okay. I've had my laugh. I've had my breather. Now back to the not-so-funny stuff. While the lawsuit went through all the stuff that lawsuits go through, mainly legal documents, responses by Jim's side to the courts, etc., James attempted and failed to raise money for a lawyer, first through GoFundMe, and then through PayPal. What was their solution? To do what they always do and start churning out more garbage, but at an even bigger level. They started spamming Greenlight with submissions, several of which were literally just the same Space Invader type game copy and pasted over and over again, sometimes in 3D, and sometimes in 2D, with most of these Space Invader ripoffs being sequels to each other. It got so bad that Valve themselves had to step in and flag Digital Homicide's known sock puppets, and even then, they found a way to work around it. Plus, on itch.io, they were selling Steam keys for their Greenlight games that hadn't even passed the Greenlight process, so people were buying keys to games that didn't even exist yet. Needless to say, the gaming community had their eyes on DigiHom and were getting sick of this, especially when there were some communities like the infamous YOLO Army who would try to get people to vote on games in Greenlight in exchange for free Steam keys. Something had to be done. Thus began Operation Cleanlight, a crusade on Steam to try and get people to give negative votes for crap games on Greenlight that didn't deserve them, and to give positive votes to games that look legitimately good. It was actually a really successful campaign, while Greenlight was around anyway, and one of the most prominent groups was Digital Homicide's Poop Games, a group that named themselves after the company who helped inspire this in the first place. So, what was Digital Homicide's response? Another lawsuit! This time, James was suing 100 Steam users, most of whom had been made John Doe's, as they were basically meant to represent anyone that James wanted that fits into the category of Steam users, for $18 million. While he said that this was because of harassment, the evidence that they provided in the lawsuit filings, something you're not actually supposed to do in the early stages of a lawsuit, and something they had done to Jim with his lawsuit as well, was entirely consisting of screenshots of negative comments about the games, not about Digital Homicide's people themselves. Unfortunately, well, for DigiHom anyway, there were some snags. For one, some of the users could end up being unable to be sued by James since they live outside of the United States. James's response, "That's okay, just shut down their Steam accounts and get rid of all the games they bought as recompense." On top of that, DigiHom also tried to get some of these Cleanlight groups labeled as hate groups and tried to get the Arizona police and the FBI to shut down their accounts.
I feel like I'm taking crazy pills!
What the hell were these guys thinking? How can you be so bad at taking criticism online that you try to legalize the freaking justice system against people who are criticizing you? Holy hell, this is one of the most insane overreactions to something someone said on the internet that I've ever seen in my entire life. But it gets better. See, you can't just sue someone that you don't have the name of in the court system, especially when a vast majority of those people could be so broad that it could represent literally anyone that the plaintiff wants. So, in order to get the names of these people, DigiHom actually tried to subpoena Valve for the names and information of some of these users. Valve responded by kicking Digital Homicide off of Steam, banning them, and removing every game they made from the Steam storefront for abusing Steam users.
You stupid!
Say what you will about Valve and the way they've handled Steam, but forcing them to dox their own customer base would be too low even for them. Say what you will about Jim Sterling and his opinions, but at least he doesn't go as far as to try and sue people who leave nasty internet comments on his videos. While DigiHom tried to threaten Valve with a lawsuit, Valve wasn't budging. And without a steady source of income, Digital Homicide collapsed, and they filed to dismiss the lawsuit against the Steam users as they could no longer afford the legal costs. While the case was dismissed without prejudice, which means that it can still be reopened by Digital Homicide without putting them in double jeopardy, that was unlikely to happen. So with one lawsuit gone, there was still another one to go. So, let's go back to the lawsuit filed against Jim. There is quite a few other accusations that James tried to sue Jim over. Under a few of his counts, he tried to say that Jim was working with ECC Games in Poland to attack and defame Digital Homicide, and that when Devil's Share and Galactic Hitman were published, they were published under Every Click Counts, but it doesn't matter anyway if they were published under ECC Games, because ECC Games is in Poland, and thus, they don't have any registry in America. Not that it was published under ECC Games, but if it was, it was totally okay! Then there's the accusation that in the article where Jim made the correction, Jim says that James and Robert are as sly as the wet bandits. I don't know why he thought that was appropriate, but okay, whatever. Then there was the accusation that Jim accidentally called James and Robert the Romino brothers, thus trying to tie them to the Mafia! Oh no! In Jim's video talking about the lawsuit, he defends himself by saying,
"What happened there was because I don't really give much of a shit about you. Sometimes I just forget your name and think it's Romino."
He also put in a tweet by Jim about ECC Games, saying they were pursuing legal action and that there was, quote, "not enough popcorn on Earth." Jim seemed to put this in because A, ECC Games didn't go through with suing the Romines. Not that you can sue a person for parroting what they were told was planned to happen by someone else. And B, because they seemed to think Jim was getting enjoyment out of the drama, which he was, but that's also not something you can sue someone for. Also, that particular count was actually countered by Jim's lawyer, Bradley Hartman, by claiming you can't prove if there's enough popcorn on Earth. He also tried to sue Jim over a Skype conversation with Valve where they asked Digihom to remove Greenlight submissions after Jim pointed out what they were doing, and saying that Jim's Ask.fm page, which was deleted, called Digital Homicide shady, which, yeah, they were. You can't sue someone over something that is incredibly accurate. Oh, and apparently some joke that Jim made in a video on Viscera Cleanup detail about games journalism, taken out of context, and not even related to Jim's situation right now, was used as evidence against him.
Perhaps this game is telling us something of the nature of player agency. It's more likely not doing that.
Why they make so much mess?
But if there's one thing I've learned about doing game journalism, it's that you can pretty much say anything about anything. And,
someone got medieval.
People will swallow it. You just ascribe some sort of artistic meaning to things. Whether that was the intention or not. Someone will believe you.
Needless to say, Jim tried to get this case thrown out for three reasons. One, James filed this lawsuit pro se, aka without a lawyer, which can be done. But as the complaints levied against Jim concerned damages to Digital Homicide Studios LLC and not James Oliver Romine Jr., it would need to be filed with a state-approved lawyer, as an individual cannot represent an LLC, whether as a plaintiff or defendant. 2. James attempted to file this case within the Arizona District Court, but in order to do so, he needed to provide minimum contact with Jim and needed to prove Jim did enough business in Arizona that he could be sued there. 3. And probably most important of all, this lawsuit was completely frivolous anyway! Now, James tried to solve the second part of the issue by purchasing one of the t-shirts Jim sold on Shark Robot, and pledging to donate $1 a month to Jim's Patreon. But these did not work, as both Shark Robot and Patreon are third-party companies. At one point, James called Jim's lawyer to ask if he could start asking formal questions, which was not legally allowed at this point in the lawsuit. Later, James filed an amended statement, which was pretty much the same lawsuit he submitted before, but now with a payment demand of $12,550,000. How the hell he got to that number, I don't know. He said it was new evidence, as well as an additional million in the punitive damages. Then, on January 13th, 2017, Jim's motion to dismiss was partially granted, stopping after the first point. The judge gave James one of two options. Either get a lawyer and actually change the plaintiff to Digital Homicide Studios LLC, or explain how the individual known as James Romine was impacted by what Jim Sterling did and not Digital Homicide. So, how did that go? It went about as well as you'd expect. The third version of this case was soon submitted, and once again had increased in damages requested to $15,326,000. James tried to argue that he himself was the sole proprietor of MicroStrategic Designs, one of the sock puppets that Jim had discovered was made for Digihom's garbage games, and that because of Jim pointing this out, this somehow counted as defamation. And then he continued to file the rest of the lawsuit as he had before. Wait, nope, hold on. James did add some new accusations at Jim. According to him, since Jim voiced in other indie games, that makes Jim a direct competitor to James, despite Jim not making any money off of the sale of those games, or even making the games in question. This, in James's mind, counts as civil conspiracy. He also adds that the Steam Cleaner and Steam Cleanlight are knowing references to harassment. Again, somehow. He even used the lawsuit to rant about the other people who have been mean to him and, oh, won't someone please think of the poor, innocent game developer! He also added the section about emotional distress that Jim somehow inflicted upon him, which, according to Jim's video on this lawsuit,
my lawyer informed me that the level of distress referenced is on par with stealing somebody's child and pretending the child had been killed.
Soon enough, Jim spoke with Bradley Hartman, who explained what would happen if this went to court, something of which Hartman also suggested to Sterling. The two sides then reached an agreement to drop the case with prejudice, meaning it can never be filed again. Well, they dropped it after James tried to one-up Jim. After sending over a signed agreement, James sent over a signed edited agreement, which could be considered attempted fraud. While we don't know what this edit was, it was quickly caught before it was filed within the court. Both sides ended up having to pay their legal fees, and James was given a written telling off by the court about how he needs to consider fair use law before trying to take down any of Jim's videos or articles again. So, that's the end of our story, right? No, dear viewers, because this story has an epilogue. After the lawsuit was dropped, Digital Homicide disappeared off the face of the internet. But the Romines didn't disappear. See, Robert had figured they needed to get their money back somehow, and thus set about creating Loot Toot Games, which were owned by the Romines. Before you go panicking, however, they don't make games. They instead basically advertise games on their social media sites and on their website. It's also reported they work with G2A, which isn't a very smart idea, but desperate times call for desperate measures, I suppose. People have given them negative feedback, however, due to their previous scummy tactics. At one point, they uploaded an edited clip from the Predator series in support of Digital Homicide.
You see, there's no stopping what can't be stopped. No killing what can't be killed.
When people left negative comments on their Facebook page, Robert Romine responded by saying that they lost more money than what most people will make in their entire lives. Which is odd when you consider they stated before that they were unable to afford a lawyer, and that James was willing to drop the case because if it somehow could go to court, not that it would involve Robert, who didn't want to put his family through that. And while it is very likely Robert would have been forced to be involved, there are other dubious claims Robert has made. Still, Digital Homicide is, for the most part, gone, and we are safe.
At least from them.
Thank you all for watching this video. I had to do a lot of rewatching of various videos on these guys, including the ones made by Dark Lord Jado, Leonard French, Down the Rabbit Hole, and of course Jim Sterling himself. I actually emailed Jim about a month beforehand asking if it was okay to make this video, and he said that I didn't need to ask, but thanked me for asking anyway. So Jim, if you're watching this, you're a great man, and I'll continue to watch your videos. As for the rest of my fans, I know this wasn't something you were expecting from me, but I figured I'd make it anyway since this topic fascinated me as it was unfolding, and I wanted to talk about it, but never felt like I had a good chance to do so until now. So once again, from the bottom of my heart, thank you for listening to me ramble on in this 13-page long video. Seriously, 13 pages of script just to make this two-parter. Anyway, I'll see you all in the next video, and until that happens, have a great day.